It was the most surreal, like, most bizarre feeling I've ever felt in my life, because I just refused to believe that that was the final siren and the game was over. And the first person I went looking for was Braith. Been friends since we were 5 years old, competed with and against each other since we were kids. 02, I was just proud to be at a club. I feel like I found myself as a footballer. I felt fit, I felt confident. I was at a strong club. I felt like I was a Bulldog junior. I was really happy where I was in my life, because a couple of years before that, I was off the rails. You know, I could have been in jail. When we came through, it was all about not letting your teammate down. That was our DNA. Turn up for your mate, fill the space. We knew that we had a special team from round one. You know, Parramatta was the rivalry, and then we put 40 on them, and it was like, all right, it's more than just footy. Like, you build a connection, a brotherhood, a friendship, and to lose Steve, like, it was a huge shock, you know. I was partying too much, I was getting in a little bit of trouble. Footy pretty much saved my life. When the club decided to move me on, I was really upset about it. When I did get the 2 year ban, it was really devastating and embarrassing for my family, and especially my Polynesian father. But for me, it was a weight off my shoulders. I knew, I was like, I'm not going to go out like this. I'm not going to be defined by this moment. Like, I'm going to come back and prove people wrong.
All right, guys, welcome back to another episode. This one was a really cool one for me. We had Reni Maitua, the Bulldogs legend, in the house. We unpacked his whole career, the ups and downs, his biggest challenges and some low points in his life and career, and he gets really open and honest about those. We unpack the 2004 season, that premiership, famous premiership season, what it was like behind closed doors and experiencing that win. And we have a really big chat about the Bulldogs 2024 season, the build and the rise of the club, and some of the ingredients he thinks we need to go to the next level and really fight for a premiership. But it gets pretty deep in some stages too, gets really raw and open about some of the challenges and experience he's had in his life. So I know you're going to enjoy this one. We'll get into it in a second. But before we do, can I ask for a few favors? For those listening on YouTube, could I get you to do me a massive favor, like this video and subscribe to the channel if you haven't already. And if you're listening on Spotify or Apple Podcasts, if you could leave us a 5-star review, I'd really appreciate it. It really helps the channel out more than you know. Thank you to everyone who's been doing it lately. It doesn't go unnoticed. So thank you. Let's get into the pod. All right, we're back with another episode. We're famous for this. We just did a good half an hour. We should have recorded it, put it live, but we'll save that conversation for another day. So I guess today, obviously, we have a lot of business ones. We have a lot of sport ones. This was one I think we connected a couple months ago, and we've had this in the calendar for a while. I'm really pumped about this. For anyone that knows me will know why. But I guess today, you know, he's played 174 NRL games, including 113 for the Bulldogs. He's represented both Australia and Samoa. He's the co-host of the They Don't Want It podcast on the BTFU network. I'm, of course, talking about Canterbury Bulldogs legend, Reni Maitua. Welcome to the podcast, brother.
Thank you so much, Dylan. And I do like the way you pronounce Samoa. Like, you got it really close. A lot of people say Samoa.
Yeah.
You said Samoa, and I appreciate it.
I'm out west, bro. Grew up like all the Tongans and Samoans, like, yeah, we fucking did all that, man. But awesome. It's just also just, you know, sometimes you can't beat your white boy, you know, accent. So I actually had an Irish accent until I was 6 years old. So I grew up with my mum and my grandparents. Yeah.
Well, you're gonna fit in Coogee, right?
I know.
It's all Irish.
It's too much for me. There's too many of them.
Can you put an Irish accent on?
No, I'm not on the podcast anyway.
Yeah,
not
because,
on the podcast.
I've a good family friend of ours, like, she's Australian, but her parents are Scottish.
Yeah.
And when she's around them, she puts a full-on Scottish accent on. And I don't have a clue what they're saying. So
well, me and my cousin get together a couple Jamisons deep. They come out reliably.
Yeah.
We're in China for the business. My cousin's like our finance manager in China for the business a few years back. And hot, you know what it's like, hot as, like, you walk outside, instant humidity, fogs up your sunnies. We're walking around, it's like mid-afternoon on like a Saturday, can't find, you know, we're on holiday, we've done our business stuff, we want to have a couple of drinks. We're walking around for ages, can't find anything that's open. We turn the corner and then we see like an Irish pub, like O'Malley's, and we're just like the holy grail. And we go in there having a chat with like the Irish owner, put all the accents and all the like locals that are there around us. Like, what are these fucking guys on? Like, but good times, man. Lot to talk about today. Obviously you had a really like successful career, a lot of cool stories about that, but I want to just kind of delve into different parts of your life and unpack them. But before we get into the journey that was your rugby league career and everything that happened off the back of that, what have you been up to lately? Obviously podcasting, but you know, give us a bit of a catch up what life's been like for any.
So, post-retirement, it's been a little bit confusing, you know. I wasn't sort of set up for life after footy. I explain it, it was like leaving school again with far more responsibility, right? So I actually retired I got into Fox.
Yeah.
I was doing like a fortnightly sort of contractual agreement. I was working at the NRL, and then a team called the Toronto Wolfpack called me up and said, you know, can you come over and play? And I'm like, I've retired 16 months ago. And they were like, we just need you for 12 games. So I got back on a plane, went over there, played 8 games, got injured, ended up spending 6 months over between the UK and Canada. But it's kind of put me back. Lifeguarding, I was, you know, helping a mate out in a factory. And then I got into the cleaning industry. So I've been in the cleaning industry for the last 5 years. Good friend of mine who owns a company, Command 51, that's Australia-wide. And in the last, I'd say 5 months, I've got into the podcasting world. So just fell into it, was a guest on an episode with the BTFU guys, and then I've got my own show, and we've got one episode to go with the grand final, maybe one more after that, and I'm looking forward to a break.
Bit of a break. It's really interesting. Like you talk about, like, all kind of happened like randomly, right? Going one podcast, don't realize. And then what was it? You did, they must have been like, fuck, Reni, really like what you did. Come in and it's like, this could be the whole next chapter of your life. From something as random as one, you know, email or message on Instagram. Because I've watched a lot of your stuff. I think, like I said to you on Instagram before, like, you're bringing something different. I really like what you're doing. Who knows what doors can open from this, yeah?
Yeah, so look, I played rugby league since I was 4 years old. So I find it quite sort of natural and a little bit easy for me to speak about footy.
Yeah.
I'm trying to get better at delivering and using the right dialogue and connecting with the audience. Mm. I cannot watch every game of rugby league. There's no way you're going to get me watching a Super Saturday or a Sunday. I just like to break down moments in the game. I like to break down the mindset of a footballer. I was lucky enough to play in the forwards and play in the halves. So I've got two different mindsets when it comes to what a player might be feeling on the
field.
Where
did you play in your juniors?
I was tiny. I was
really?
Like a halfback and a fullback.
Far out. It's a big transition.
Yeah, yeah. And then as I got a little bit older and went into sort of flag, I built into, I think, the Polynesian side of my body started to catch up, develop, and the quads blew out and I ended up in the back row. So, you know, like early on in my career, I found that I was a little bit sort of detrimental because I wanted just to nail one position.
Mm.
But if there was an injury, I'd be able to play 5'8" or play centre. But, you know, ultimately, I wanted to play in the back row.
Speaking of your ability and skill that you picked up, you know, playing footy your whole life, of breaking down certain moments and tactics and plays or whatever that may be, there's one thing you've spoken about this before, but it really fascinated me. You put it up on your podcast maybe a month or two ago, talking about the 2006 game, top of the table clash, Bulldogs versus Dragons, and the way that the forward pack in particular used to conduct business. Now, I know a lot of Doggies fans will be listening to this just because they want to hear your story. What was it like? What was that 04 pack, like that era? What made you guys so different? Because it was crazy to watch. Going back and I watched that whole 10-minute clip of this fucking rough and tumble stuff. What was it about your gameplay or your style that made the 2004 Bulldogs so different?
Ego.
Yeah.
We were just a young pack of forwards that were just full of bravado and ego. Like, we all wanted to outdo each other. We didn't care who we played against. It was all a competition, and it started at training. Who's the best on the roll? Who could bench the most? Who was the fittest? And it transferred onto the field. Like, if Sonny Bill came out and put a shot on an opposing player, then I'd be shooting out of the line trying to do it. Then Willie would shoot out of the line. And we'd feed off the back of someone like Mark O'Mealy. So we were just like a young, fearless, aggressive pack. And the game you're referring to, 06 against the Dragons.
Yeah, Cogra.
If you go back and watch that, it's not normal.
Like, yeah, it's not.
It is not normal. And, you know, Dragons came back at us, but most of the hits in that game, you'd have a 12-match suspension, yeah. Right? So, and that was and we had really good camaraderie. Like, we were really good mates, and we spent a lot of time together off the field. So that was a great period, but like that pack in particular, you gotta have the right chemistry. And we had a good balance of senior players, young players, and hungry players.
Who were the leaders in the four pack at that time? Because like you said, a lot of you were quite young.
off the field, on the field as well, Tony Grimaldi and Corey Hughes, Adam Perry, Steve Price, on the field and off the field, Marco Mealy, he was the alpha male, Willie Mason. And then you just throw in Roy Asatasi and Sonny Bill, and I was lucky enough to be thrown in there, and Jonathan Thurston's coming off the bench. Like, it's all about chemistry. It's like having the right balance, and we had it.
Marco Mealy's built, like, the team is built different, but Marco Mealy, you haven't really seen too many people play like he has since. Like, the amount of, like, if you had to hazard a guess, and with HIAs, if the HIAs are in the game now, you couldn't have it in a Marco Mealy game. The amount of plays he left knocked on the floor, unconscious, dazed, like, and crazy.
And his teammates are training. The amount of people that he hurt from the ogre, even at training, you know, he was built different, you know, come from the country. Played first grade at a young age. Just, he was wired different. Mm. Right? And you knew on the bus, on the way to the game, he'd have his headphones on, and you knew he was in the zone. And when you're in the dressing room with the ogre, it's refreshing to look across and just know that he's your teammate.
Right? Is he still around the game at all? Is he doing any coaching or mentoring?
Yeah, he's at the club. He's doing a lot of pathway stuff. Very analytical, like
really.
That's the way the game's going. Mm-hmm. Does all the video, cuts video. He I think he lives up towards Wyong. He'll come down to Belmore. He'll do 12-hour days, 6 days a week. He's just on the computer trying to teach these young forwards. He's always wanted to get into coaching, and mate, he's great. He's great. I went down to a session recently, and just the level of detail coming from the ogre that was my. Oh, yeah. I was like, he's the same ogre, I know.
Exactly. I think a lot of people would be surprised to hear you explain the way he is now after seeing the way he played.
Really good footy brain, because when we played together, it was like ogre just wanted the ball and he wanted to bash, barge, and kill.
Just move the mic up for us, right? What's it like? So you've been back around some sessions. What's it like? Obviously, you've been a part of the glory days of the club. Obviously, there was the 80s and 90s as well where the club was really good. But in terms of like NRL era, the more recent stuff, you're really part of that. What's it been like for you as someone who's at the club in a period of, you know, really good times and success, and then seeing, you know, apart from this year, the last 8 years have been probably the lowest period for our club. How have you reflected, and what have your thoughts been on the year that was, and getting around the team, seeing the coaching staff and the culture start to get back to where it was before?
Yeah, so I went back there in 14 after a short stint at Parramatta, and Des Hasler was there. Mm. And probably within the first couple of weeks, it felt different. Just didn't feel like Canterbury. The work ethic was there, but the DNA of the club, it just wasn't the same. It was probably more of a Manly style, I guess, you know, like Des, obviously Manly, great.
Yeah.
And it just didn't feel right. And then once I left the club, I mean, there was a period I went over to the UK. I wasn't following the club as much. And obviously when they're not doing as well, I kind of tend to have just not watched the footy anymore. Mm. Since Serrato went there, he started bringing back the old players and showing them the 06 video. And he wanted to know what the DNA was of the club. And I think the important thing for the Dogs is them to create their own identity. So you got the 80s, you got the entertainers, and then you got the 90s, like parts of the Dogs of War, and then our era was Dogs of War as well. I think it's important that the foundation stays the same with the club. It's built on the family and hard work and integrity, but they need to find out what their identity is and what their DNA is, and they found it this year. I think they're just lacking some key players in certain areas, but they're in the right direction.
What do you think we're missing? Because again, massively overachieved compared to what everyone predicted before the end of the year. If you were to say we're even competing for a top eight spot, let alone competing for top four up until 2 weeks before the end of the season, a lot of people would be really surprised. We've obviously got Satili Tupanua, who since he signed with the Dogs has been playing some great footy. So great signing. Tom Amone, who's had a couple of really big years over in the Super League. So that'll help with the forward depth. What else do you think we need? Is another enforcer in the forwards, a link to like the likes of Leo Thompson from Newcastle, or maybe some experience in the spine? What's your read on it?
Definitely some size. We definitely need some experience in in the forward pack and some size. I think, you know, respectfully, we were lucky, probably the first game against Manly before the semi-finals. I think the blueprint was there for how to beat the Dogs. Just a little bit too small.
They're just off contact. They were knocking us back a metre or two.
Yeah, finding their front, quick play of the balls, and it's hard to defend. A thing for me this year was I found that the club was – the boys were so – they had so much belief in their side that they backed their defensive patterns and their defensive system, but they were still making too many errors. And I knew that it would probably catch up with them in the back end of the season in terms of fatigue. It's – fatigue is emotional, physical fatigue. It's a real thing. If you're not completing and you get to the back end of the season, it's gonna play a part. So I think we definitely need some size. I think Tom Amone, I watched a little bit with him. Lee, I believe he's at.
Okay.
Don't know too much about him, but he's a strong front rower.
Not this season. Last year, I think he was forward of the – like he won like whatever the Dally M prop of the year was. So he's had some good – yeah. But again, as an Aussie, we don't really follow it too much. Yeah. But I know he's had at least a really good, you know, season or so over there.
So he great signing. Front rows, great. Tupanua, great signing. I love Jacob Preston. I'm a huge fan.
He's one of my favorites. Yeah, same. Came out of nowhere at the start of last year.
There was raps on him.
Mm-hmm. And the Roosters was with him and let him go or something.
Manly.
Yeah, that does ring a bell. Maybe.
Huge raps. And then this year, you know, he's gone to another level. So you got two great back rowers there.
Yep.
I'm really impressed with Kurt Mann.
He was we noticed when he got injured back end of the year how important he was.
Yeah, we definitely missed him.
He's the glue in the middle of the field, yeah?
A little guy. Not a big guy at all, just tough.
Speaking of little guys, someone who is like the one who took me by surprise most this year, Bailey Hayward. Coming to the team and never left.
Absolutely.
Just a quick one from me. If you've been listening to the podcast for a while, you'd know that after scaling Happy Skin Co. to over $10 million per year, I spent close to 18 months creating the Viral Brand Builder program, which teaches someone with zero experience how to launch and scale their very own e-commerce brand. With over 100 training videos and direct access to me, including one-on-one calls, you'll be guided throughout the entire process. Now, we already have a bunch of incredible results from students that are making multiple 5 and 6 figures per month. So if you want to learn how to build a business that has the potential to completely change your life, then click the link in the description and book in an application call today. Spots are limited as you'll be speaking directly to me. So hopefully I'll chat to some of you soon. But until then, let's get back to the podcast.
I say it on the podcast all the time. The 14 is coming back into the game. So the utility, there was Craig Wing, Kurt Gidley. You know, I was playing a lot of 14. So having that utility on the bench is really, really important, especially how quick the game is now.
Yeah.
The game is so fast that having a 14 like Haywood come on, straighten up the attack, a little bit of deception, pass when he needs to, you know, good defender. I think most teams now will go back to that 14 utility role. I think maybe what else we need. Sherry's been outstanding. Obviously,
first year back to be performing at that level.
Yep.
I think he's got – I was surprised with how well he started, but I think Sherry, particularly with like decision-making in attack and defense, back end of the year, he was really impressive.
Really good. Connor Tracy just plays well above his weight.
When he moved to fullback, I think that's when we took another level up as well.
Yeah. I don't know if he's the long-term answer. I appreciate, I really do appreciate how good he is for our club. Long-term, I'm just not too sure. Toby Sexton's done really well.
Done really well.
Again, question marks? Like,
Mitch Woods is like probably the young kid with the most raps that anyone's had on him for the last probably 5-10 years, you know?
Yeah, he's the number one half in the country right now.
Yeah.
I've had a little bit to do with him in the pathways. Great kid.
Yep.
I think the Swans wanted him at one stage.
All three codes wanted him apparently.
Yeah, but he's still a few years off.
Mm-hmm.
I want to see Toby and Birdo work together behind a strong forward pack. Right?
Yeah.
So, I think of the Sharks winning it in 16, I believe. Chad Townsend, right? He just got nothing you around fancy. The par, nothing fancy. He wasn't really quick, but just did a job, you know. So I can see that similarity there where if he's behind a good pack, then maybe he just does his job and leave the strike to Sherry, to Critter. I love Caraz.
Oh, he's great.
He's an extra forward on the field.
I think he ran the most meters in the comp this year.
Yeah, he's outstanding. So the club's building. We just need to sprinkle in a little bit of talent here. Not talent, bit of size, I believe. Bit of game management.
And I think as well with like Burden and Sexton, how they complement each other. Burden's long kicking game. When he missed that set, was the second last game of the season when he had that HIA. Like we're getting tackled on tackle, like last play on the 30 meter line. He's kicking the ball down, landing it between the 10 and then goal. It just gets us out of so much trouble.
I think he has like a 6 second hang time when he kicks.
It's ridiculous.
So that gives the defensive side that much time to get down there and you know, keep a team in the back end of their field. So that is extremely important, you know. And if I was him, I'd be looking at maybe an NFL contract.
After? Don't put any ideas in his head.
Not yet. But, like, imagine getting paid the amount of money they get paid.
Just to launch it.
Just kick the ball.
He sends it like no one else. Like,
well, I was surprised he kicked it short for the first drop goal in Manly.
Yeah. I think we got a couple back, didn't we? I think we got some success from that.
So, no, well, in the semi-final, he went for the first one and it fell short and he had the win behind him.
I was at the game. I had a perfect view and I'm like, fuck, he's got the line perfect. It would have been half a metre short.
Yeah. I mean, he'd nail that any other day. So, mate, I question whether he was a 5'8 at first.
A lot of people did.
I thought maybe put him back to the centres and, you know, just figure out who the halves are. But as the year went on, you know, Ciro and the coaching staff, they see what we don't see. They're there every day at training. And I really love how they've developed his game as a six. Mm. He runs when he needs to and gives the ball early to kick out.
Yeah, because we've got so much strike down that left side. He doesn't need to, you know, try and overcomplicate things.
Absolutely.
And then with Sexton, he was great this year. But I think one thing that would have made him even better if they didn't, because the year before when he joined us from Titans halfway through the year, he had the most six again, like restart, like his short kicking game, just threading it through was great. What's your thoughts on that? A lot of the, you know, like Bloke and a lot of the other podcasts have said they're not really a massive fan of the changes. I don't like it either. There's no reward for building pressure.
No reward.
Put a drop kick up 50-50.
I hate it.
Same.
I hope they change.
Me too.
Change it.
Me too.
I believe they brought it in because of the head knocks, whatever, blah, blah, blah. But
how's that different to a kickoff?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Exactly. So, you know, these guys like Reynolds and Thurston, Kronk and all these halves have spent hours and hours and hours of their time to perfect the short kicking game, to build pressure and give your team a repeat set. And then now you're rewarding the opposition with a 50-50 with no consequence. You know, they don't get it right. There's no penalty. It's a turnover.
Or worst case, you're 10 centimeters off, seven tackle set from the 20 as well. Like there's so much risk. You need a reward there. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like,
It's a stupid rule, and I know there's been a lot of noise around it. Mm. I'm hoping they get rid of it this year.
Yeah, like a lot of people that, you know, are pretty – a lot more well-educated than me on the game, I do agree with you. So, again, as just a standard fan, I agree. You mentioned Critter. What sort of impact do you think he's had at the club?
He's been outstanding, man. For a 23-year-old kid to see what he's done and turn that club around, the connection they've built – the aura, his presence. I'll see him in the dressing room when I'll go to a few games here and there.
Yeah.
He'll always come over, he'll look you in the eye, shake your hand. This is a good kid.
Yeah.
You know, he walks through you know, with the speaker and has everyone involved. And players like that are priceless to have around the club. You know, like you need good leaders, you need good people around the club because it only takes one. Two bad people or bad, you know, bad influences on the group that can destroy a complete culture. So he's outstanding.
And I don't think a lot of Doggies fans, like we were excited, you know, these people I've been speaking with were excited when we signed him, but I don't think we knew half of what we were getting.
I didn't know. You
Is he going to be center, fullback? You thought, you know, he's good at pulling out those, you know, clutch moments, try savers or scoring the winning try, intercepts, all that sort of stuff. But that's secondary to what he's brought in terms of leadership and connection with the boys.
Absolutely. You got to have people like that around the club. And I just can't speak highly enough of him.
Mm.
You know, I don't obviously know him that well. And obviously a really class player.
Mm-hmm.
I heard Serrato do an interview and they spoke about Critter, and he didn't even know that he was going to be that much of a leader and have that much influence when he went to the club. You know, like he's 23 years old, won three comps, you know, like three comps.
Is this enough for me? Sorry, Yuri's giving me funny looks. I'm trying to translate. Yeah. All good.
Three comps.
At 23 years old.
23 years old.
Crazy.
Unbelievable.
And like we spoke about Jacob Carraz before, he's a meter eater. Like Critter isn't necessarily going to be topping the stats, but it's whatever you need a tough carry. He's the one there putting his body on the line. He'll hit it hard. He'll push through. He'll find his front, get up, quick play the ball. He does the tough stuff too. And I just think, what a fucking inspirational leader.
He's a finisher as well. Like not many players, like he might not have a whole heap of involvement in a game, but when the game's on the line, he knows where to find the try line.
Yeah.
You know, he's done it in a couple of grand finals, the intercept against South, the try against Brisbane before Cleary.
Yeah.
Like he got him back in the game. He knows when the game's on the line, he can find that try line.
100%. One last thing about the current crop of Bulldogs. We'll move on. We've got plenty of other things to talk about as well. I feel like we can't talk about Critter without also talking about Cam Serrato.
Yeah.
And I just, you know, I've been a lifelong Bulldogs fan. I've never, you know, like I was young, you know, in the Steve Folks day. So I didn't really appreciate, you know, I was 11 when you won the comp, you know what I mean? So it's like, I've seen, yeah.
I've 11. Seen, wow.
Cause you were young, you were as early in your career as well. But I still fucking remember it, you know, clear as day. And I've seen a lot of coaches and, you know, Des Hazel took us to two grand finals, got close, but then everything that happened and, you know, like all the coaches I've never, like I'm a fan, not even a fucking, you know, and I'd run through brick walls for Ciro, let alone what the players must feel for him.
Well, I played against Ciro. He's younger than me. And
he is. He's like late 30s or something, right?
Late 30s, maybe just 40.
Yeah.
When I went down to the club this year, Willie Mason invited me down. And I always heard rumors that the Penrith defensive system came from Ciro.
Mm-hmm.
So I'd go down to the pathways and I'd go watch SG ball train. And the level of detail in their defensive patterns, I was mesmerized. I could not believe it. And like they're pretty simple movements, but they were really impressive patterns. And to be able to do that with your Matthew Shield, your SG ball, your flag, your reserve rate, it obviously sets them up for first grade. And I'm thinking, how did he even think of these drills? You know, he put these drills together for all different types of scenarios in a game. So it's to see the way they defend now, like at the end of the day, when we came through, it was all about not letting your teammate down. Like that was our DNA. Turn up for your mate, fill the space. It was a very basic sort of defensive pattern. He's just perfected it, right? So you can see they hunt as a pack.
Mm.
They hunt, you know. And that's the difference between maybe a Penrith and a Canterbury. And you watch the lesser teams, or I look at the Cowboys, or I look at, you know, Roosters to some capacity, and I watch their middles and the way they move. It's nothing like a Penrith or a Melbourne or a Dogs.
Mm.
There's just something ingrained, something different that's bled into them to make sure, hey, when the game's at any point of a game, do not let your teammate down, feel the space, kick pressure, line speed, hit to hurt, intent. And I love it. And that's what the Bulldogs build on.
And what do you make of, like, how do you explain the stat, how do you explain this in your words? Like, you saw second best defensive team in the comp, I think by the end, not too far behind Penrith the last couple of games, we conceded some points. and then where one, like the most or one of the most missed tackles at the same time. Like you think those two things aren't compatible, but somehow it showed that the system's there, it can still really work.
I think it's maybe two factors, maybe their size. I think maybe they're a little bit too small compared to other packs. But I think the other factor is Ciro wants them, he wants line speed and he wants intent. If you happen to get bumped off, you're confident that the guy next to you is going to get in and make the tackle, and then you can get back into the tackle, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does.
So it was a level of, hey, this is the process. We don't ever lose this process. But when you get up in that line, you can put a shot on. And if it means missing a tackle, we have confidence in the players around us that are going to clean it up across the park. You know, they've all got each other's back.
And I think another thing that the team's had, similar to your era, I think, you know, from memory, obviously I was quite young, but something that the Bulldogs of that era of your time prided themselves on was being the fittest team in the comp as well. The strength and conditioning sessions and the fitness sessions under Folksy, who I think I read something at one point, like he'd run the fucking laps with you and beat us. Beat the boys. It's like
he beat us in fitness tests. He loved. So we had a guy named Gary Carden. I've spoken about him a lot. I owe my career to him. He, myself, Sonny Bill, Braith, Willie Mason, Jonathan Thurston, Ben Harris, like his resume would be the best in the NRL. If you got through Gaz, he gave Folksy confidence that these kids were ready to play first grade. Folksy used to beat us in most things, but he loved bike riding. So we'd go and buy these $4,000-$5,000 bikes, like proper races.
Yeah.
You know, there's annoying people on the street that are riding a pack and the Lycra. And he loved the Tour de France. And we would do these rides, these preseason rides. And I'm probably the hardest rides I've ever done. You know, we're all 100 kilos plus on these bikes. We'd ride from Cronulla to Waterfall. Down through the national park.
So hilly and stuff as well.
Oh, 5 kilometer hills, out of the saddle, down Gary Hill. If people know Gary Hill, it's just steep decline, and then you have to ride back up it 6 times. We go down to Bundina, we'd camp the night, ride all the way back through, and this was like every preseason. I don't know how like any of us got seriously hurt. Like, We were moving quick on these bikes, and if you lost the pack, you were gone. So you'd try and stay on the back of someone for 50, 60 kilometers, and then if you fell off, if you broke mentally, your ride would turn into an extra, I don't know, maybe 2 hours. So folks, he loved the bike rides, and that's why he probably won. But he could run, very fit human, great guy. I spoke to Willie Mason recently. He would have been in his early 40s when he was coaching our team. I thought, I'm in my early 40s now. There's no way I could have put up with myself, Sonny, Willie Mason, you know. Yeah. And I thought, what a human to be able to put up with a group of young guys that were a little bit off the rails, but they could play footy.
You just need that. You had the right amount of off the rails to put on the field and have that, like you said, that ego and use it for good, right? To, you know, put it towards a common goal and just rip and tear.
That's right. I mean, even though we were pretty loose and we liked to have a drink, we knew that on Monday we'd turn up and rip in as well. But the longer you do that, eventually it's going to be detrimental.
And different errors, you know, it's probably less common these days. But just before we move on past that, how was obviously heartbreaking news a few years back now when I think only 59 years old, you know, out on one of his runs or something. How did that affect you and the boys? Were you guys in shock? Obviously wouldn't have expected it at such a young age.
Well, we didn't all drift apart, but I was actually really close with Karen, his wife, and she passed away before Steve. Steve and I had nothing in common. I mean that in the nicest way possible. A huge amount of respect. He didn't drink, didn't eat junk food. He was just like that non-negotiable, hey, we're here to do a job. He'd only have to give me a look if he was disappointed and I'd be shitting myself, just going, oh, you know. his wife, Karen, she understood me. Like, I think I really got along with his wife, Karen. And like, I remember we had one drink. I had a drinking ban and we're at Corey Hughes' 30th backyard party. And folks, he said, "Rennie, you're not drinking today." But Karen would sneak up the back of the party and just give me these vodka cruises back in the day. But unfortunately, Karen passed away from cancer. And then when we lost Steve, I mean, it was just a huge shock, you know. Like, in 2004 and 5 and 6, it's more than just footy. Like, you build a connection, a brotherhood, a friendship. Blood, sweat, tears. There's so much emotion and that goes into the game. It's not just what you see on a weekend for 80 minutes. Like, the places you go mentally, physically, emotionally, in pre-seasons, in the season, in injury, it's just so much more than just footy. And to lose Steve, like, it was a huge shock, you know, a massive shock. And it still hurts, you know, like, just to get that news that, when you look at someone that's you feels invincible and then they pass, it's, yeah, it was a very sad time.
Because he's had the 20-year anniversary this year of the Premiership.
Yeah.
Would have obviously been a different feel to have him around, but, like, that's the thing about life. Like, one of the fittest guy anyone who knew, tomorrow's never promised. That's the thing, right?
That's the thing. And when we won the grand final, well, before the grand final, we said, you have to eat a Big Mac. Because he hadn't eaten McDonald's for like 30 years. And that was the deal. Like, we win, you eat a Big Mac. And he still wouldn't eat the Big Mac.
Man. You've spoken about that period. Like, so 05, a lot of injuries. But then 06, you guys, one of the best teams in the comp again. You've spoken about having a bit of regret for not building more of a dynasty. Just, you know, just one premiership. Obviously, there was the 02 where, you know, best team by a mile and all that drama happened. And then you joined the club, I think, played a couple of years in flag and the New South Wales Cup, whatever reserve grade was called back then. During that time, what was it like? You obviously would have been like 18 or something, quite young, to be in the four walls of that club during that, you know, really challenging period. Did they shelter the players much from that, or was it like siege mentality? How did it feel when you joined the club?
Well, is this 02?
02, yeah.
Yeah, right. Look, I was just happy to get through the preseason, you know. Being a Rabbitoh, mode, yeah. I was just survival. I mean, everything was so foreign to me. Coming from the Rabbitohs in a flag side that wasn't doing too well, Braith gets me over there, and the sessions are designed to break you, like really, really tough sessions. And I remember thinking, what have I done here? Like, this is too hard. And then, like, there was a shift in my mentality. I probably started to mature a little bit more, or a lot more. And I started to get a little bit competitive. You know, this player's in front of you, this player's in front of you, this player's in front of you. He dropped off, he dropped off, he dropped off. And next thing I know, I've got Travis Norton, Steve Reid, and Glenn Hughes, these guys that have played, you know, 150 first-rate games. They were my focus now. As, you know, even though we're at the same club, I'm trying to take
their
spot.
You've got
to
be like that, right?
Yeah, 100%. Yeah.
So that's the game.
02, I was just proud to be at a club. And I feel like I found myself as a footballer. I felt fit. I felt confident. I was at a strong club. I felt like I was a Bulldog junior. When they got the salary cap stuff that went on, it didn't really affect me. I was really happy where I was in my life, because a couple of years before that, I was off the rails. You know, I could have been in jail. So I'd found my place in society and in a good club, and I was enjoying footy again. But yeah, it didn't affect me as much. But looking back on it now and winning it in 04, I know how much it meant to them from 02. That was building and building. You know, I inherited the 04 rivalry.
Yeah.
So that's when I had to fully buy in.
So what was, you know, 05, a lot of injuries, 2006, obviously a lot of disappointment. I think you were up by quite a bit at halftime. What happened there? Like, what do you put that down to, letting that moment go? Because like you said, I heard you on a podcast, I think, speaking about after you won that first premiership, you're like, I'll win five more of these, no worries.
Oh, look, 06 really burns because that's when I was in my third year of first grade and I felt like I do not a deserve, but I earned my place in the team. I was starting in the lineup and you know, I played a little bit of city country and for the Australian PM. So I felt like I belonged and I felt like this was our squad building towards a grand final. Whereas 04, myself, Sonny, Thurston, Roy, Willie Tonga, we were just a piece of the puzzle, you know, an important piece of the puzzle. But 06, it was like, all right, we're building our own sort of legacy here. We were like, had a great year. Braith had left.
So was 06, was he already at Roosters?
He was already at Roosters.
Who was our 5'8"? Who was 5'8" then?
For Daniel Holdsworth.
Oh, Holdsworth, yeah.
Nate Miles come on the scene. We still had a great side, you know, and, you know, Willie Tonga. But we had an unbelievable team. And then we just started to drop off at the back end of the year with injury. Roy Asatasi and I got surgery after the last regular season game. We just made it back for the Brisbane game. So we went in for surgery straight away. Daniel Holdsworth did his ankle in the semifinal in that game. And then we just slowly, you know, capitulated and 20-6 at halftime, walking up the tunnel. Willie Mason yells out 40 minutes to the grand final, boys. And I'm just like, you didn't say that. But I don't blame Willie.
No, of course. Yeah.
I G him up about it. But when I heard that, I thought, oh, fuck. You didn't just say that.
Was that the Broncos? Did they still have their massive pack then?
They had Tony Carroll, Dane Carlo, Webke.
Sinavasiva there?
Sinavasiva, Darren, you know, Lockyer, Hodges. They were a stacked team. I truly believe we were the two best teams that year. I thought whoever won that game was going to go on and beat Melbourne in the grand final. Being up 20-6, we should have went on with the game, but we were limping into those semifinals and we would have been limping into that grand final as well.
I feel like you don't, mate, like maybe I'm wrong, but like if you look at just the Dogs and the Broncos pack back then, you don't tend to see packs stacked as much as obviously salary cap and balancing all that. You can't stack four packs like that anymore.
I just look, I have nothing but respect for the packs that are around these days, especially that Penrith pack. But I feel like when I first started, you know, Brisbane had a pack. You think about Brisbane pack in 04, they had Carl Webb, Dane Carlaw, Brad Thorne, Gordy, Sivanasiva, Pritis. Was Pritter still there? 04, no, he won 03. Like, that was a pack, you know, and that's in my first year of first grade. And then you've got the Pulitua, Nullavau, Joel Clinton, Marty Lang, Pritters, Penrith pack. And then you had Jason Roll, Sean Timmons, Luke Bailey. Like, that was a pack. Parramatta had Kalis, Highmarsh. You know, there was a lot of good, strong packs back then, whereas now there's good packs, but the one pack that stands out for me is obviously Penrith. You know, and I don't know if what's changed in our game, but I just think there was far more competitive packs back then.
I think the Melbourne like success has changed that as well, realizing like they've done it to the extreme, spent like however much of their salary cap on their spine. You know, they've always had three or four gun players and they somehow Bellamy finds a way to bring these middling, with no disrespect, players at other clubs, bringing them in and getting like a 6-7 out of 10 player to play 8s, 9s out of 10 every week.
Yeah.
And they've just somehow been able to maintain that level of success. Obviously this, I'm not sure if this will come out, probably come out around grand final week, but who's your tip now with for the grand final with a couple of weeks left?
I can't go past Penrith. I mean,
it's hard to go past them.
I mean, Melbourne have been great. I really enjoyed what I saw from the Roosters last week against Manly. But I just look at Penrith and I just, they are special.
Yeah.
And someone asked me, would our 04 team beat the current Penrith side from any of the last three grand finals? And I said, yes, we would. One thing we wouldn't beat them in is backing up every year and being competitive. Like, to be able to do that every year, preseason after preseason, you know, 27 rounds, get through semifinals. I win one premiership. I'm like, you know, yeah. You start to take your foot off the gas. You know, 06, I wanted it, maybe two. Now they're going for four. They're built, you know, and I respect them so much. And it's more of the fact, not just only their talent, but to be able to just keep winning and wanting to win.
It's the mental side of it is almost harder. Like, to continue, keep getting up like that.
Yeah.
Year after year, I think it's already unprecedented in recent time. Like three comps in a row. If they do four and they're in the grand final the year before that and they won the minor premiership that year, probably the best comp that for 5 years of fucking best team in the comp.
In the modern era.
In the modern era, that's great. Yeah. And look, since the last 3 years, they lost Appy, then they lost, you know, all the boys to Dogs, Critter, Burden, Kickow. They lose Luai next year. Mm-hmm. Who's going to be surprised if they're still, you know, Fisher Harris will go.
Yeah.
Won't be one bit surprised to still see him in the top four and, you know, favourites to go to another grand final.
They've just got a great system out there. And it's just a conveyor belt, right?
Yeah.
Like you develop these players from under 16s. By the time they get to 20, they already know what's expected. And then the next one comes in.
I feel like your game style, because you're like a bit of a skillful forward, you probably would have suited playing in the modern era though. You feel like that would be the case?
I'd like to think so. I mean, I had more of a halfback's IQ that played in the back row. I'd like to see, I see back rowers now and they just do this one job, like hit inside the three man, hit inside the three man, hit inside the three man, run a bit of an outline. But your job is to essentially get their opposition halfback to make a poor decision. I'd like to try and help my 5'8 out when I was playing. And because the 5'8's got so much going on, or the half, and they have to keep an eye on the ball and count numbers and where's the opportunity, where are we on the field, I always like to tip my half up and be an extra half out beside my half and say, listen, we've got opportunities, pull the trigger, now. Because just getting that sort of voice outside of the half, it gives them more confidence to see what's going on the field.
Who did you play outside of more at Dog, Sherwin or Braith?
Braith, but then he ended up at more Holdsworth.
Yep.
But Sherwin, like Shifty and I had a really good combination. Me, Shifty, and Luke Patton.
Yeah.
So a lot of the general. A lot of my line breaks or tries came off Shifty or the general. We had a really good sort of understanding of what they were going to do. So, it was funny. I preferred to play left side, but I had far more success on the right side.
Really?
I don't know why.
Yeah, interesting. I would have thought you would have been a left side dominant player outside the six, but you played a bit of lock as well, right?
Lock, center. 5'8".
Yeah.
It was, you know, looking back now, it was great to be able to sort of be that person to fix situation, you know.
And it's kind of what's becoming like really in vogue now.
Yeah.
Like
if
you can have one or two of those in your team, or Bulldogs, you know, people are laughing at them in the sense of, oh, signing all these utilities.
Yeah.
It's like really, well, it's not the case, but it's really great to have.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Well, whenever Braith was out or Thurston was out, I'd have to play 5'8". And Willie Tonga and I were really close. And Willie Tonga back in 04, if anyone remembers.
He's a beast.
Like, look at his highlights.
Beast. Good luck trying to stop him.
So him and Braith had this connection where Braith just knew where to put the ball. He'd spiral like a bullet pass. Tonga would catch it like an NFL player and just do his thing. When I played inside him, I'd do an end over end pass and it'd just sort of wobble through the air and he wouldn't be too happy about it. So Every time Braith or Thurston came back into the side, I think Willie Tonga was a lot happier than playing outside me.
I noticed, to go back a little bit further in time, for your debut game, I think you were named in like the 19 jersey.
Yeah.
Were you late in, or was that just a plan, a smoke screen to, you know, not put too much pressure on your debut? No,
I wasn't meant to play. Glenn Hughes tore his hamstring in captain's run.
Oh, so you had like an hour notice?
Pretty much. Yeah. And then I was lucky enough not to lose my spot, so...
What was that moment like? Obviously, you don't have too much time to think of it. Got in the side. Were you told, you know, by the coaching staff, you know, in the preseason that, hey, this would be your year, you'd definitely play some first grade? And then?
No. So I was the last player picked in the top 25 squad back then.
Wow.
I don't think I was on, was I off contract? Yeah, I would have been off contract. They weren't sure if I was going to develop any further. Like I wasn't. Playing amazing in reserve grade. I was just sort of doing a job. Mm-hmm. And then when we went away for our first trials in first grade in back end of 03, start of 04, folks, he put me in the centers and then put me in the back row. And I think I sort of shocked him a little bit because I could play center. And then I was, I guess one of my strengths being a smaller forward was that I was aggressive. I think that more came out of fear than just trying to be tough. You know, I thought these guys are a lot bigger, a lot more experienced. I've got to do something different. I've got to be different. You know, I've got to show that I can mix it with these first graders. So, folks, he was really close to picking me in that side in 04, but he went with experience, which was Glenn. And then, Glenn got injured and the rest was history.
What point in that season, you mentioned you're a team had a lot of ego, a lot of chips on the shoulder, wanted to compete for everything, even against each other at training. And I've heard Mace share stories about kind of, you know, his perspective of the year. But what point in the season did you guys realize that, fuck, here, we're the team to beat here, boys? Do you remember, was there a moment where you're
round
like-
Round one. Against Parramatta. Like, I think we put 40 on them. And, you know, Willie Tonks, Sonny's debut, two line breaks.
So you debuted in the same game?
Yeah, myself, Sonny and Willie Tonga were living together and we all debuted together in that game. Willie Tonga had already debuted at Parramatta, but he was only 19. Sonny was 18 and I think I was 20. And we knew that we had a special team from round one. You know, Parramatta was the rivalry and then we put 40 on them and it was like, all right, because 02, 03, there was Jamie Feeney, Dennis Scott, Steve Reid, and Glenn Hughes, Travis Norton. They were like Smith. They were good enough. The 17 in a row, they were the best team.
What year was that?
It was 02, and they lost the points. 03, I think they realized there was something missing.
Mm.
And then myself, Thurston, Sonny, Roy Asatasi, Willie Tonga came in. And we might have
what
been
a crop.
I think we might have just been that last piece of the puzzle to win in 04, yeah.
Like the names you just mentioned, they're some of the best players to ever play. Literally, if you look at like particularly obviously yourself as a Tarzan Willie Tonga, obviously achieved crazy things, but JT and Sonny Bill Williams, two of the greatest, like in the conversation for GOAT status to ever play. And you played coming through the grades with them too.
Yeah.
Did you know how special they were going to be at that point?
Sonny was unbelievable. He's best back row to ever play a game. Like, if he stayed in league.
I wish he did. Even though he left Dogs, just to watch more of him play in his prime would have been.
Just some of the things he did on the field, his offloads, his aggression, his hits, his work ethic. Tough kid. Thurston and I played in the 02 grand final together for reserve grade. And watching Thursto play, like he competed on both sides of the ball at training, kicking goals from sideline. Like he was special, but everyone was sort of worried about his size. He had a few injuries in 03 and then 04, he had a few injuries as well. But if you watch the semifinals and see some of the touches that he had in the semifinals in 04, he was elite. Like some kicks, support play, scores a try against Melbourne. with limited minutes, you saw how special he was. And then obviously to go up to the Cowboys and become the player he was no surprise to me. I consider Jono the best player I've ever seen. So for him, it was sad to see him go, but for him to go up to the Cowboys, win a premiership for that club.
On his back as well.
On his back.
Off his boot really, but yeah.
And I've reconnected with Jono a little bit, not for any other reason than he was living up in North Queensland, but now he's with Channel 9. We get to catch up here and there. But, yeah, he's always a good laugh.
It makes like, you know, for Doggies fans, he's the one that got away. It's like, what could have been in that period if there was a way to keep JT at the club?
But you had Braith and Shifty.
I know, what could you do, right? He left and people were obviously I was young, but like people were disappointed about it. But I don't think we realized one of the goats is fucking leaving either.
Yeah. I mean, Braith and Shifty were playing so well.
Yeah.
I knew what we were losing. It was sad to see him go. I wanted him to play one more game, and that was the World Club Challenge in 2005. So when we went over to play Leeds over there, it would have been nice just to have him in the team.
So he was already with Cowboys.
He's already with the Cowboys.
I've asked like Blake Austin, asked like Jackson Hastings, like a few of the boys that have spent time over there. What do you think? Because obviously you look at the NRL standard, it's well above Super League, but why do so many Super League teams win the World Club Challenge?
No one wants to play in England.
That's a short. Well, they fucking beat Penrith when they came out here.
Yeah, I don't know. They've got more of a carefree style of play, right? Mm. So that it's far more attacking based. We're built around structure. And I've always said this with Melbourne, Penrith, Roosters. When you unsettle their defensive patterns with offload, second phase, you know, ad lib footy, as NRL players, it's all unusual because you're used to having a defensive line that shuts a play down. You get back in the line, shuts a play down, get back in the line. But all of a sudden you'll get up and then the ball starts moving again. And it's like this scramble kind of defense that they're used to. We struggle with that. And that's the way I see, for example, Sharks beating Penrith. They got to play, shift the ball in transition, second phase, offloads. And Super League are good at that. Mm. They're really good.
What have your thoughts? I think Ramian's out and I think KL Iro is in a bit of doubt. What's your thoughts about him this year? He's been really impressive, right, Iro, for the Sharks?
Been really good, really raw sort of kid. Still a lot to learn, but as an athlete?
Yeah. Like physically, the amount of work he can get through consistently, really impressive.
Needs to develop a pass. I know. I know I'm not going to mention his name, but I know someone on the coaching staff at the Sharks. Yeah. And I said, please teach him how to pass because I saw him blow a try recently, but outstanding player. Yeah. Outstanding.
First onto the scene. I want to talk a little bit more about obviously the grand final day. Were you guys down at halftime, right? I think you guys are down.
Yeah.
By a try or two.
13.
Maybe 13-6. What was, do you remember, obviously it was so long ago and I'm sure there's a massive party following, which I'll ask about in a second, but do you remember the halftime talk or amongst the boys or what was like, you going out there, obviously you're only 7 points behind, you're still fucking right in it, but what was the, like, if you can remember what was going on with the boys?
I've watched it back and I think it's one of the worst grand finals that we've ever had in history because there was so much hype around Bulldogs and Roosters that we both shit ourselves. There was so much drop ball, uncharacteristic errors. It was a little bit wet. I don't remember what was said at halftime. I just know that we always believed, like it was a never say die attitude. We had a person called Matt Utai who scores that the first try in the second half. He carries like three people
That's
over,
right.
You know, with 30 centimeters off the sideline. I can't remember exactly what was said, but there was a period I think when and then Haslam scored.
I think Utai scored two and Haslam scored one.
Yeah. And then if you watch, there was a period where for about 10, 12 minutes where we should have just flogged them. Like, we should have put the game away. We had them under the pump. And then what I do remember is the last 10 minutes, like the last maybe 10, 12 minutes, and just the scramble, like scramble, turn up for each other, fill the space. The biggest moment I remember of the game is Braith Anasta spraying me, like absolutely spraying me, because Chris Flannery beat me on my inside shoulder. Like just a little step, and it was Braith just like, fuck, that's not good enough, Ren, you know, and that stuck in my head because it was that never let your teammate down attitude. And that last 10 minutes, that's what we're all about, was just turn up. But that wasn't just for 10 minutes of a grand final. That was three years of preparation, 4 years of preparation.
How are the levels of exhaustion, grand final, holding on to a small lead, last 10 minutes, are you just completely on empty, just going on adrenaline? How do you get through that?
So the first, I started the game because Steve Price was out.
Yeah, you started at lock. Well, I was looking at the team sheet before.
Sonny, Roy.
Oh, because Mace went into Thurston, would have went into the front row.
And then I started.
Yeah, then you started.
I made, I think it was like 22 tackles in 18 minutes. And I remember they replaced me and I thought, how am I going to go back on? Like exhausted.
How many interchanges could you get back then? Was it eight?
Oh, it would have been eight.
Eight, I think, yeah.
Eight or 10 or something like that. But I remember coming off just thinking, that was the hardest 20 minutes of my life. Like I was just there to tackle. When I went back on for my second stint, I think they were getting a lot of repeat sets. I get interchanged and I remember just thinking, thank God, like I was done. You know, they're attacking our line. And Willie Mason was crawling over the dead ball line. He got replaced as well. So we were just, there was a, you know, a level of exhaustion that you can't explain. Like the place your mind can go to, especially under fatigue, it's scary, right? But when the game was on the line, we had enough, you know, good leaders and just hardworking players in that side, like Grimaldi, like Bobcat, like Corey Hughes, like across the board, that we were going to keep turning up for each other and help each other out in those important moments. So you can go to some dark places. And I remember the last sort of 5 minutes of 10 minutes of being on the field, the first 20 and the last maybe 5 minutes when I was on the field in the second half, I was ready to come off.
And that's where those 50-kilometer bike rides up and down the hills, that's where they pay off, right?
Comes into play.
There's two moments that stick out in my memory from watching the game. There was a couple of Hazem's kicks from the sideline. Couldn't fucking watch. I was that nervous.
Yeah.
And then last play of the game, they make a break or a half break. Andrew Ryan just gets a half tackle, half ankle tap, brings him down. I think they knock on. What was going through your head when you see the ball hit the ground, Andrew Ryan make that tackle?
When the hooter went, it was the most surreal, like most bizarre feeling I've ever felt in my life, because I just refused to believe that that was the final siren and the game was over. I was like, nah, what? I just won a premiership?
Yeah.
Like, and the first person I went looking for was Braith, you know, because Braith and I have been friends since we were 5 years old, competed with and against each other since we were kids. And that feeling of running on, hugging your teammates, knowing what you went through, it's hard to explain. I think someone explained it. It's like having your first child. Not that I'm a father, but that's as close to it. And I think that'd be pretty special. So
it, obviously having it, I'm sure I don't have any kids either. Having a child is like the most special thing you can experience. But also most people, like, it's pretty easy to have a kid if you want. It's fucking hard to win a premiership. And it's like, there's no guarantees that you get one.
No.
You can play 10, 15 years, some players, and still don't get one.
Correct. And I thought we were going to win 10.
Yeah.
You know, my first year, and that's probably the biggest regret, is like, I wish I soaked in a lot more moments. I drank, I reckon, you know, when they bring out the champagne?
Yep.
I think I drank the whole bottle. It's about 10 liters of it. You know, you're holding a bottle like this big. And I'm pretty sure I drank most of it.
What did and how long do they go for? Because I think a bunch of yous ended up with doggies tattoos later in the week. What were the celebrations look like? What we can share on a podcast, I'm sure. We've got pretty rowdy.
The most peaceful moment after the game, like, because there's so much media, there's family. Corey Hughes has got John Howard in a headlock. And it was just a period where we all sat in a circle in the showers with the trophy in the middle, being away from everyone, and just sharing a beer. Not much was said, and just staring at the wind, just staring at Norm Proven and Arthur Summons. Like,
special.
We just did that, you know? And that's one thing that little bit of peace and just that quiet to be able to appreciate the moment with my teammates, that sticks out a lot for me.
What's the difference in a feeling? Because, you know, you just play park sport, you know, if your friends and you're winning grand final, it fucking means something. What's the difference in feeling like if you won a grand final coming to the grades, whatever, different age groups? Did you win a grand final in the lower grades as a junior or anything?
Yep.
How different is the feeling from winning one of them, which is still fucking on top of the world, versus winning a like NRL first grade grand final?
I think it, look, growing up, like I remember all my grand final wins and the ones I lost as a kid, and it was always against Braith. Like it was either, because we played in different teams, it was either beat him or he beat me. So that I was scarred obviously when we lost, but to win one in the NRL, I think it means more to knowing that how my parents were feeling at that time, that, you know, all the sacrifices they made for their kids, especially mum, but especially dad as well, coming from the islands, trying to have a better life for his family, loved his sport, pushed me pretty hard into footy. Like, I think it meant a lot more probably to them, knowing that their son had achieved something that they had a big part of, you know, with all the sacrifices they made to take me to training, take me to games, take me to rep games, drive me here, drive me there. So to win a premiership, it's just, there's just so many years of hard work that's gone into that moment. That, like I said before, I wish I appreciated the moment a lot more.
I think that's just, you know, and that's great for people to get to win multiple premierships, because you get to relive that. And I think each time you do it, you kind of appreciate, you know, what it takes. But it's the same in business. Like, I have a kind of conversations with, you know, for me, my life changed, you know, essentially overnight. Our first year of business, I grew up out west. We made over $10 million in our first year. I went from, like, by the time we paid for the stock, I had less than $1,000 in my bank account. Wow. Then to the next year, I had over, you know, I had millions.
Yeah.
And it's like same thing. I loved it and it was the best time, but I feel like you just get caught up so into that's just the normality of things. You don't realize how special it is. I think people do that regardless if it's sport, if it's business, if it's whatever.
Yeah.
And I think as you get older and you have more of these experiences, you can realize, fuck, like how precious those moments are. And particularly for you, you've spoken about this before. You were like, you know, you're one of the kids that footy came pretty naturally to you. You're talented kid, didn't have to work too hard relatively in the early stages. And you had a bit of a choice. Do you, you know, waste your potential and just go and do what everyone else does, get on the tours and party and go to the beach? And you kind of went down that path for a bit. Talk to me about that year as a plumber, and then what made you realize, fuck, wait a minute. Like, was it a fear of not fulfilling your potential? What was the thing that clicked that made you realize, I'm going to just give this footy thing 100% crack?
I just didn't want to be a plumber. Pretty much.
Real life, there you go. It's
all, you know, like I'd played footy for so long, and without sounding like egotistic, it was, I knew I could play the game, but I was having more fun hanging out with my mates, going surfing, playing up. Then when I went out into the real world and left school, and by that time I'd given away football for a couple of years, it was a real sliding door moment for me. It was this. I was 17, maybe 18. Braith was playing first grade, plays against Manly, sets up 4 tries, scores 1. And I remember sitting on watching the television, drinking a throwdown of VB, these little VB bottles back in the day. And it was just that moment I went, fuck, I've got to get back to footy. Like, what am I doing with my life, you know? And I worked hard. Like, I obviously went back, trialed with South, got signed with Canterbury, won a grand final 02. 03 went well. 04 won a grand final. 05 got picked in at City Country and the Australian Prime Ministers. 06 get picked for Australia. But in that period where I worked so hard and was so committed and so dedicated, I forgot what got me there. And then that's from 07 onwards, is that's when I just went back to my old ways. And it's like you said, it's not appreciating and having gratitude for what got me there. So there was a few defining factors like early, and plumbing was one of them. Like, I thought, I can't do this for the rest of my life. Braith's doing well. I was partying too much. I was getting in a little bit of trouble. Footy pretty much saved my life. But that lasted, like, I thought in that five-year period where everything was going really well, I forgot what got me there.
Yeah, like, you work so hard to get to the top and, you know, your talent will take you so far, but then it's like everyone else is that hungry, everyone else is pushing, everyone else has their standards here.
Yep.
Eventually, if you don't continue to live up to what got you to where you are, you're going to fall back regardless of how talented you were, yeah?
Absolutely.
So talk about you leaving the Bulldogs and how you felt knowing that obviously you would come back to the club and down the line, but how you felt at that time knowing that your time in the club was over.
Yeah, that was tough. You know, it was a bit of a pill to swallow because I was full of ego by then. When the club decided to move me on, I was really upset about it. I remember, like, I was going down a pretty bad path and I actually sat the players down in 07, 08, and I said, guys, look, I love this club so much and I love you boys that I think it's time for me to move on. I need to find a new club. I need a fresh start. And my teammates being my mates said, no, Ren, we got you back. We got you back. We want you to stay. And I was like, boys, no, I need to leave. I'm too comfortable here. I need a new challenge. And obviously the players have my back. They're like, no, Ren, stay. And then I had an off-field incident at the end of 08 and I got sacked. And that was fair enough. You know, the club had to move on from me. And I knew it was coming. I knew it was coming. And it's no excuse. It was just a period where I thought, all right, once I got sacked, I signed with the Sharks. And I thought my life would change and everything, but there was so many underlying factors and off-field dramas that I hadn't addressed that I just took with me to the Sharks. You know, there was a period where I was doing really well, but then it just came back again. It's all based around alcohol. Always has. And that was every sort of incident I've had within the game has always been based around alcohol. So let that be a lesson to all kids alcohol and sport or being an athlete do not mix at all.
Yeah, I think even more so the further you got into your career, like if you go back to like you hear interviews of people talking about what it was like in the 80s and 90s, that it was a cultural thing, but as the modern day athlete, it's not compatible for one, the standards in terms of absolutely how athletically not challenging it is, but two, social media, how high profile you are, how you do anything that, you know, would have just got, you know, gone through, no big drama before. Yeah, sure, it might have been some naughty little indiscretions, but nothing would come of it. Nowadays, players look at someone wrong and it's all over the news, you know what I mean?
Yeah, it's a different culture. I came into a culture where you finish the game, everyone's having a beer. Mm. You're on the bus, everyone's having a beer. You party hard, you trained hard. And then as I got towards the back end of my career, it became more science-based, you know, and I was stuck between the old school and trying to become part of the new school, but it was too late.
Yeah. There was another like sliding doors moment for you. You mentioned, you know, when you went to Cronulla and you took some of your bad habits with you, you then had, you know, that incident happened where we had 2 years away from the game.
there was talk, you know, doing research, you could have appealed it like some other people had, but you knew you did something wrong. Not that you didn't go out and do that, but you're like, you know what? I won't be able to live with myself. And then you had 2 years off. You spent essentially a year partying. What made you think, fuck, you know, I've got another year to go? Was it just one moment you looked yourself in the mirror and realized, I want to get back in shape and see if I still have it? What changed for you after that year of just, you know, partying essentially?
So just to like bring it back just a fraction, when I did get the 2 year ban, it was really devastating and embarrassing for my family and especially my Polynesian father. But for me, it was a weight off my shoulders. It was like, I don't have to play this game anymore. You know, I wasn't enjoying it. It was more of a chore. It was more a means to an end to pay my bills. I just didn't have that passion for the game anymore. You know, my social life and professional life were just so far out of whack. So that first year that I was suspended, I was wild. Like, not dangerously wild. Like, I wasn't hurting anyone or getting in trouble from the law, but if there was a party, I'd be the last one to leave. Like, I just
self-destructive.
And then again, it was just like another moment where I went, what am I doing? What am I doing? And I got on a plane and went to Thailand and I spent a month over at Tiger Muay Thai and trained 6 days a week, twice a day, and then came back and rang my manager and said, find me a club. Like, I knew, I was like, I'm not going to go out like this. I'm not going to be defined by this moment. Like, I'm going to come back and prove people wrong that I can still play rugby league. Originally, I was meant to go back to the Dog.
I heard that. What's the story there?
I met with Ray Dibb, who was the chairman at the time, and all I wanted to do was go back to the Dogs. There was a verbal agreement, Ren. Go away. This was after Thailand and I think I was going on another holiday. When you get back, there'll be a contract for you. Go away, come back, no contract. Completely reneged on it. Whatever. And then I had a meeting with Melbourne down at the Storm. I met with Frank Pranisi and another guy. We drove around Melbourne and for me being such a Sydney boy, I thought, I can't live down here.
Yeah.
We go into a cafe and Bellamy's there and we sit there. I had a little bit to do with him in the Australian team. He was one of the assistant coaches and he was just like dead, looked me in the eye and said, I don't care what you've done. F this, F that. I love the way you play. I want you at this club. I got on the plane thinking I'm moving to Melbourne. Then I go meet with Parramatta. And they just played in the grand final in 2009 and Jared Hayne was there and Hindy and I were teammates in the Australian team in 2006. Melbourne offered me a one-year deal. Parramatta offered me a two-year deal. I went with the security. It's funny to laugh about it now. I was like, why don't I go to Melbourne? They want a premiership the next year. But Parramatta, as hard as it was to go there and how much we struggled and didn't have many wins, I owe that club a lot. To take a chance on a 29-year-old that's just spent 2 years out of the game, I couldn't speak highly enough of the club. Yeah, it has its flaws.
You were one of the captains as well for a year.
I came back. So 2011, I came back. My suspension was up. It's halfway through the year. I go back, they put me with Wentworthfield, the reserve grade side. I play one game. I get poked in the eye in the first minute. So then I don't play. There's cameras there. Rennie's come back. And I last a minute because I like genuinely couldn't, my eye was closed. I play another two or three games in reserve grade. And I got my timing back and I was like doing quite okay. And Brad Arthur kept coming to me saying, Steve Coney spoke to you yet? And I'm like, nah. He's like, we need you in first grade. And I'm like, mate, I'm not the coach. Like, and I'm four games back.
So was Brad Arthur the assistant?
I'm four games back into my career, essentially after 2 years. And I don't know what Mooks, or we called him Mooks, Steve Coney was doing. And then I get picked in the New South Wales reserve grade side after four games. Brett Cormorley was the coach. And I went and saw Steve Kearney. I said, mate, they've picked me in the New South Wales residence. Like, I'm going to go play. And he goes, so I kind of forced his hand and then came back and played in first grade at Parramatta. And although we didn't do well that season, I was just really proud to get back in the first grade side and sort of finish the year in first grade. And 2012, we had a rough year. I think that might have been Hindy's last year.
I think so, from memory.
And then 13, yeah, they made me captain, co-captain, which was, you know, bizarre because I knew I wasn't a captain. You know, maybe captain off the field,
yeah,
socially, but not on the field.
Was any part of you thought, you know, what version of Reni Maitua would have came out if you went down to Melbourne? Because like I said before, Craig Bellamy, I'm sure someone with your talent, and if you could integrate to Melbourne not being in Sydney, who knows?
Look, yeah, you know, like everything happens for a reason, and that's what I truly, truly believe. Melbourne was pretty much on the other side of the world for me because I was such a Sydney boy.
Such a Sydney boy, yeah.
But then when I went to Parramatta, that was on the other side of the world for me too.
Yeah.
You know, driving out to Parramatta, I was thinking, Jesus.
I've never been this far west.
Where am I? You know, and, but 2.5 years, it was painful, but some great mates.
Were you doing the commute from the east to Parramatta every day?
The first year and a half, I had an apartment out there. I just refused to be out there. So So the first year and a half I was driving out there, and then I succumbed. I was like, I can't do this.
It's too much.
Too much. So I moved to Parramatta 2013 and lived out there for the year. But that alone, being away from my family, you know, people might think, oh, you're only in Parramatta. I was away from my family a lot, you know. I couldn't just jump in the car and just drive down the road to see mum, dad, and all the siblings and nieces and nephews. So, yeah, I ended up moving out there, and then our man Ricky Stewart came along, or he was there in 2013. We had a bit of a falling out, and I got to go back to the Dogs.
Yeah, how did you end up going back to the Dogs?
So I was telling this story recently. I was a co-captain with Jared Hayne and Tim Manor.
Yeah.
And we played against I'd already had I had Ricky Stewart with the Australian team, and I had Ricky Stewart with the Sharks. And then he was coming to Parramatta. And then before he came to Parramatta, he rang me. He said, hey, like, what version of Reni Maitua am I getting? And I'm like, Stick, I got your back. And that's where I built up a lot of, like, I've got to do this for Rick. I loved him as a player. I respect him as a person. And I still do. That I put so much pressure on myself into that preseason. Like, I was trained. I went back to Thailand during the Christmas break just to stay fit.
Get a bit of a head start.
For some reason, my body couldn't keep up. I was 31, maybe 32, but I just wanted something so bad and my body wasn't responding. I started the season okay. He made me, he said, Reni, you're captain. And I'm like, mate, I'm not a captain. Reni, all your peers want you to be captain. I'm like, mate, I'm not a captain. He goes, all right, I'll make yourself, Jared, and Tim Manor captains.
What was the hesitancy coming from?
I just, deep down, I was more concerned about, like, if you put me in a video session, I'll be the loudest in the room and I'll say, guys, we need to do this, we need to do that. But a captain is a leader 24/7. I knew I wasn't a leader 24/7. I like to have a good time, have a laugh, eat crap food when I want to eat crap food, train hard when I needed to train hard. Like, I had more of a balance of everything. I just wasn't a 24/7 leader, you know.
I know what you mean. It is like when you understand what leadership truly is, you realize it's all encompassing.
Yes.
It's a lot bigger than people think from the outside looking in. Who's talking the most on field? That's one small part of it.
And it's a lonely place as well, right? So halfway through the year we played the Titans in Mudgee, and Ricky was on one. Like, when Ricky comes in with bloodshot eyes, he's been on my
I can only imagine, yeah.
We did a 90-minute captain's run the day before a game, full contact, because he was on one. We play the Titans the next day. Everyone's busted, like from the day before. In Mudgee, we're playing at altitude as well. Like, and we get back to the hotel. The boys are sitting around the hotel and they're like, "Reni, your captain, you got to go in and see Ricky and say that's not good enough." I'm like, "Jared, Tim, like, you guys are captains as well." But they were a lot younger than me. Mm. So I went in to see Ricky and said, "Mate, it's just not on, you know." And when his eyes lit up and the veins started popping out the side of his head, I thought, maybe I said the wrong thing. And then a day later, he had a board of 12 players that were no longer wanted at the club, and I was one of them. Out of the 12 players, he showed me the respect that he called me in that morning and said, "You're on the list." I said, "I'll leave the club as long as I get every cent that I'm owed for the following year." And then, yeah, got a call from Des Hasler and I was at the Dogs.
That's the price of leadership.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
And going in to try and tell the coach how to coach.
Yeah. Who would you say is the best captain you played with? Does anyone stand out?
James Graham and Mick Ennis. I wouldn't say probably the two best motivators I'd ever played under. When I went back there in 14, I didn't know anything about James Graham. I knew a little bit about Mick. I kind of knew him. The way they spoke before a game, every single game, not only motivating but just clear, to the point, these are the expectations, this is what we need from the team, and then they back it up on the field every single game. So I've got a heap of respect for James Graham and Mick Ennis. Like, just the way they motivated the boys and then delivered on the field, that's a leader, that's a captain.
I listened to your podcast with James Graham. It was really, really good chat. What was your experience in the UK like? Did you enjoy it over there?
I loved it.
Sounded like a bit of fun, huh?
Just, look, in my head I built this scenario that everyone gave a shit about who I was and everyone gave a crap about footy players. That's the bubble of rugby league in Sydney, right? And I just created this stupid scenario. And then when I went over there, I realized how insignificant NRL is and Sydney, you know, in the whole rugby league world. I thought, fuck, what was I so caught up in? You know, I'm over there. No one knows who you are. There's not as much pressure. I love my history. I can go to a castle here. I can go there. I can travel through Europe. I just loved it. And the English are great people. Like similar sense of humor. And footy just became fun again. Yeah. And I wish I went earlier, to be honest. But when I went over, my last game was 50 in front of 50,000 people against Manly in a semi-final. I got sent off for throwing a punch. Nearly cost us the season, or we nearly didn't make it to the grand final because I got sent off in that game. And then my first game back in rugby league was at a place called Batley. The field is like a hill. It's like a cow paddock, playing in front of 200 people and just freezing cold. So just the complete polar opposites of what my last game in Sydney was and then my first game over there was. And I thought, shit, what have I done? As the season went on, and then I ended up going to Salford and playing Super League with Tim Sheen, so I knew I made the right decision. And because, like, I used to get a lot of anxiety about being out in public on my own. Like, I couldn't go to a shopping centre on my own. I had to overcome that by moving to England on my own, not know anyone, and that made me develop as a human as well. So,
but it's the perspective. Everyone is the, like, particularly when you're, you know, one of the star players from the NRL, you're in Sydney, you're in that bubble. Everyone already feels like they're the main character in the world, in their own story. And everyone is like, you walk past someone on the street and like you see them for a second and just know all the problems you have, everything they're stressing out about,
you know, all the drama in your life, they're going through it too. Everyone is, you know, the main character in their own world. But when you have all this pressure and this built up expectation, like everyone's thinking about me and what I'm doing right and what I'm doing wrong. Yep. It's like a lot of times when I have chats with some of the boys that went over to the Super League, they'll be like, fuck, I could finally just enjoy footy again without all that extra stuff, right?
So like I said, like the average fan, like all they see is 80 minutes of footy. And you might have a shocking game and they'll go, he's crap and blah, blah, blah. And the footy player, the person that has the bad game, will hold on to that for hours, days, weeks. Whereas the person criticizing the player, you don't give a shit the next day when he's working at a job site. It's gone.
Yeah.
It's done.
Yeah.
We carry this bullshit in our head. A lot of players do. We can't let go or we worry about what people think. And that's not all footy players, but that's who I was.
Did you play in the age towards the back end of your career? Was social media much of a thing yet or you were kind of out before that really became?
It was only like forums.
Yeah, okay.
I used to go on a forum and if someone like the boys, get off that forum. Yeah. Like, no, this guy said something about me.
Yeah.
And then there was Bebo and MySpace.
Yeah, those days. That's hilarious.
MSN.
Yeah.
That was as good as it got for me back in the day. Now you've got
everything. How the players deal with it now. And people like, you know, on their high horse, just ignore it. It's just comments. They're fucking human beings as well.
Well, just being in the podcast world right now, like I read comments on YouTube.
Yeah.
And there'll be like 15, because it's not that big at the moment, 15 like great comments. And there's just that one that pisses me off. And I'm like, how do I find out who this person is, you know? And it's just the way we're built. Like we all want to be loved. And as the season's gone on and in the podcast world or even on social media and those negative comments, being older, it's like, whatever.
100%. And I think like for me, why I'm so fucking paranoid with the mics is because every now and then we'll get a comment, why is the audio so shit, bro? I'm like, and like it just burns, it annoys you. And you're like, all right, like you just feel like you don't engage, but in your head, you're like, all right, you go do better. You produce a better podcast. Yeah. And it's like, it's not good. And like, I've been in like the personal development space, you know, pretty consciously trying to better myself and my mindset, my life for probably close to 10 years now and still me. It gets you and it burns you. Like we're saying, some things you got to like just disengage with that sort of stuff because it's not worth it. But on that sort of like mental health thing, you've had like your own journey with mental health over the years and spoken pretty publicly about some of your challenges. And by no means are you someone out here trying to be a mental health advocate and you're saying, you know, I've got all the answers. But rehearing that story again that you experienced, I think it was 2013 with Willy Tonga. Yeah. You know, we've come a long way in the mental health space in the last 11 years since then. You would have been one of the first high profile athletes, at least looking back and reflecting, to come out and speak about, you know, the challenges that you had and that footy players are people and we experience, you know, you experience depression and challenges in your life like anyone else. Did you realize at the moment, you know, when you finally came out to speak about it, how big of a deal it would have been?
I didn't till, I think after I did the Channel 9 thing, right? Like it was more, the media found out about it. All right, tell your story. Didn't really think too much of it. It was the reaction from the public. Like the amount, I've still found messages in my Facebook that are so deep into the message, like, thank you, thank you, thank you for speaking up.
Wow.
So I had no idea. Mm. I had no idea the challenge, well, the whole mental health space, right? So I've lost a lot of people to suicide in my life. From 15, I've best friend, cousin, my older brother took his life. That's another story, but if, you know, that's someone in my family. There's been far too much of it. And James Graham asked me about it. And I just said, I still don't know what the answer is. And I sometimes get torn between talking about it too much and not talking about it enough. All I can do in my space now is like, I get really worried about my nieces and nephews now, especially that my nephew's getting a bit older and he watches old clips and he wants, he's asking his father, why was uncle like that? Because I'm so happy around the kids, you know? But yeah, I just, unless, to go back to your question, I didn't realize the gravity of coming out and saying something. And it almost made me feel a little bit guilty as well, especially when I went to St. John of God in Concord and was having group therapy. I realized how insignificant my problems were to the people in that room. In my head, it was the worst thing in the world. Like, you can never take that away from someone. When someone's, you know, going through pain, that's their reality, right? But when you step outside the phone booth and you realize, okay, what's going on here? You're self-medicating, you know, you're drinking copious amounts of alcohol, you're trying to numb the pain. It's a form of depression, but I wasn't clinically depressed. I was just trying to numb a pain because I couldn't get, I wasn't able to achieve my goals in the sport that I loved at that time. And now reflecting on it now and going to these group therapy sessions and stuff like that, I thought, fuck, man, there's so many, there's people with far bigger problems than the problems I had. That was just my reality at the time.
But to my previous point, like you said, you feel when you're in that problem you're facing right now is the be all and end all.
Absolutely. And that's why you'll never ever judge a person for what they're going through. If you think, oh, if they're going through something that seems just not even worth worrying about, you, to them it's everything. You know, you've got to show that sort of compassion for someone and go, that's their reality and that's what hurts and they're built different. You've got to be supportive. Yeah, because never underestimate what someone's going through, if that makes sense, you know?
Yeah. And like, I think it's a really good point to have because like now, you know, with the benefit of experience and maturity, you can look back at what was getting you so down then and you have the perspective to realize, yeah, look, you know, there were other things I wish I achieved and could have done, but I'm sure the amount of messages from family, friends, or the boys that would have said, fuck, above all else, like, we're just so glad you're still here. No one cared if you didn't play, you know, 10 tests and 20 origins or whatever was in your head, right?
Yeah.
No one cared about that. Only thing that they cared about is Reni the person. But in your head, you're probably thinking, I'm a failure. I didn't live up to, you know, all these things.
100%. I needed the, I don't know if the word, the silver lining and all that, but for me to go through that and to where I am now, life is so much fucking harder now, paying bills, you know, inflation, cost of living, a mortgage, trying to look after mom, and the amount of like pressure that I'm under, everyone is under, is just so much harder than what I went through back then, you know. But if I didn't go through that and learn, pick up some skills, one book that changed my life was The Power of Now.
Yeah, great book.
I'd listen to it every single night and on audiobook. I'm not much of a reader, but that put a, that was my therapy. I threw the Lexapro out the window and said, no, I'm not taking this antidepressant bullshit. Just gave me perspective on shit and then it gave me life lessons. And now, like, post-retirement and where I'm at, like in the last 2 years, there's been days where I've had $8 in my account, but I can sit back and go, I know I'm going to turn that around. Mm. And then within a week, you know, money's in my account, paying my bills. And then when I get to these low points, all right, I know how to deal with that. I was taught that from that previous experience I went through in 2013. So there's lessons to be learned, you know?
Because like you said as well, and this is what, you know, people can't understand unless they've lived the life of a professional athlete. It's like you're finishing high school when you're 32 years old, but you don't have the life experience of a 32-year-old to know, you know, how to get a normal job, how to manage all your bills, how to pay your mortgage, how to do X, Y, Z, all these things. And you just got to try to figure it out.
You got to figure it out. And I still don't know how to do it.
What's the hardest part, do you think, about becoming a professional athlete and that being your life for 10, 15, 20 years, and then trying to transition into a normal life off the back of it. There is no fucking one simple answer, but what do you think is the biggest challenge that these athletes are facing?
Not having the support of, like, when I'm at a club, I get told what to eat, when to train, what time to be there. You got physio. Everything's handed to you. Like, this is what you need to be an athlete. This is what we need. This is the support we're going to give you to be the best player you can be on the weekend. When you retire, I don't have my manager to ring, hey, I need to do my tax. How do I book a flight? What's an ABN? How do I get a bank loan? None of that support's around you.
Whose responsibility is it? And, like, are the things being done? Has it changed much? Is it the RLPA? Is it the clubs? Is it the NRL? Whose responsibility is it to have, like, you know, there's pathways going into the NRL. There should be pathways going out of the NRL as well.
I will never play the victim mentality. I think it's up to, I blame myself for not picking up those skills. There were things in place late in my career to make sure that my transition was as smooth as possible. I think a lot of players miss the connection. Like, I miss the dressing room. I miss my mates. I miss all the training, the camaraderie, all that. Too many players that I know will play a victim mentality in the first 3 years of retirement. Say, oh, the NRL should have done this and done that. And at the core of it, you're a fucking adult and you need to make choices for yourself. You know, it's all about, don't lean on anyone else. Go out and do it. And that's what really, like, drives me up the wall a bit, seeing a retired player play a victim mentality. Yeah, the NRL could have put more things in place. They are putting things in place. They can't hold our hand through life after retirement, you know. It's up to the individual, and it's all about choices, and you have to make the choice. Like, we can be handed everything, but if you're not willing to do it, then you're going to end up in a dark place.
100%. Yeah, that's a great answer. I've asked a bunch of people that question. I've never heard a response like that, but it's true, right? Mm. It's true. It's like, at the end of the day, yes, most of you guys have been playing straight out of school, finished school early, even for some of them didn't have any of that benefit of real life experience, but you're still a fucking adult at the end of the day, absolutely, right? Like, no, it's intense and there's a lot going on. And like you said, it's good if more things are being done, but it's making the choice to take advantage of the options for education or whatever it is that they have going on to do, start thinking about that, you know, back end of your career. So it can be more of a seamless thing. One last thing I want to talk about before we wrap up is, as you mentioned, you got out of playing career. You went to the UK, came back. You know, a lot of athletes post-career struggle with a bit of an identity crisis, like, what now? What next? You bounced around with a couple of things, got into the cleaning industry. You've been in that for 5 years, managing like a district for that big company you mentioned.
Yep.
And then you went out on your own for a little bit. And, you know, my job is consulting to people starting businesses, mainly in the e-com space, but people think being a business is really easy. And that's e-com. I'm sure there's even more complexities with that industry. What was your experience and lessons like from 6 months going it alone?
Awful. No, it wasn't awful. Look, I just thought it'd be far easier.
Yeah.
With our network, and I just didn't realize how much came with business, right? And I'm a shy person. I don't like to ask for help. Like, I knew I had a lot of the right people around me just to say, hey, what do I do here? How do I do this? How do I do that? You know, I would go out and network, and then I'd feel uncomfortable in a setting where I'm around business people. Some of these people are like big hitters, like a lot of money in the room. And I'd be so intimidated because I didn't understand the dialogue. All I had to do was ask questions, right? They're really nice people. And it just got to a point where I just didn't back myself enough. I'm not a shark. I wanted things to happen organically. I wanted it all, but I wasn't willing to take the small steps to make it work, you know, and learn more about business. And I'll give it another crack one day. I just wasn't ready at that point in time, because I just thought with my network and it happened just like that.
I think there's like, yeah, as long as you take the lessons from that and then you, then whenever it, you decide to do that again, you've got the benefit of the experience.
Yeah.
And to learn from those lessons. It seems like obviously, fuck, I'm not in that world at all, but it seems like that's one of the things, obviously great mates with Braith, that the Roosters do really well in terms of like, as a club, as like the gold standard. It seems like if players go there and you spend a few years there, they drill it into you, connections, education, and everything like that. Would you say that's pretty
fair? It's all about connections. And that's one thing that I regret is like when you go to these corporate functions after games and stuff like that, go and have a conversation. Ask questions. Like that's one thing that I'd always be too shy to do. Like, hey, I don't understand what you're saying there. Can you give me some advice here? Or just when, like in your younger years and you get invited to these functions, all you're thinking about is I want to get the hell out of here. You know, I don't want to
fulfilling an obligation.
So yeah, tick a box, get me out of here. My biggest advice to players now is just go and connect with as many people as possible in all different industries. Go and ask questions. You know, there is so much opportunity out there. You know, we come from a team environment, so you could essentially say that, you know, we're team players and we're all about, you know, working in an environment, like we can be good leaders in amongst people. But when you go to these corporate functions, just tap into it, like even with your board members or whatever it is, like, mate, life is short, but it's a long time. You got a long time after footy. Make the most of it while you're in it, because there are some good people within footy clubs that are big fans but want to help as well.
Yeah, I think that's great advice to anyone listening. And, you know, you've been out of the game for a little bit of time now, starting to figure all this shit out. Like you said, you had to figure it all out on yourself, take responsibility, the onus is on you.
Yep.
But it's cool, bro. I love, you know, seeing you enter the space again more in the rugby league landscape. I've loved, you know, your addition to what you've brought out, getting into the podcasting space and media space, something pretty new for you. So a whole other bunch of challenges, but yeah. Coming up to the end of the season, you know, big plans for the podcast next year. What is like your takeaway from your first year at podcasting, and then what are you looking forward to jump into next year?
More preparation, watch more footy. Without saying too much, I feel like there's some big things coming next year and I'm really excited about it. I guess I built up a lot of anxiety about coming back into the space of the social sphere and putting myself back out on Instagram. Was like, do I really want to do this? But now I'm like, okay, I'm comfortable. I know where I'm at. Getting sort of like little, it's building, which is great. And if we can pull off a couple of deals over the next couple of weeks, I'm really, really excited for next year. So I'm doing something that I love. Like, don't get me wrong, the cleaning industry is great. Friends of mine own the company, but I feel like I've got more to offer, and rugby league is where I feel comfortable.
Yeah. Like I said, I'm so glad that you came back to the game, and a few of the players from your era have. I think it would be a loss to everyone around the game that loves the game and consuming the content around it, not to have you boys as part of it. So thanks for coming back. For those that want to follow either you or the podcast, where's the best place that they can follow along?
Just follow me. It's just Reni Maitua at Reni Maitua, yep, on Instagram.
Yeah.
You can see that the BTFU sport, that'll take you to our show on YouTube. They don't want it. It's on Spotify and all.
Yeah. Beautiful, brother. Well, thank you so much. Really appreciate you giving your time. It was an honor to meet you as a Doggies fan. So thanks so much, bro.
All good.
Looking forward to seeing a lot more to come from Reni throughout 2025.
We're going to talk conspiracies.
There'll be another podcast coming, Reni Maitua on conspiracies. It's coming. Yeah. It's coming.
All right, guys, thank you so much for listening. If you enjoyed this episode or you got something out of it, do yourself a favor, do me a favor, do your friends a favor and share this with them, and they can come along on this journey with us. Thanks again, and I'll see you next time.